There's no reloading components in stock. We can't do any load development, right? Well, not on this channel. If you wanted to say there's nothing available, and maybe close to you there isn't. But for today's video, I took a trip to one of my favorite places, just a little over an hour away. With what I could find at my local shop, as well as what I could find online, there is load development to be done. And today we're going to cover the first step of my load development process with two different powders. Depending on how hard you've been looking, my results may be different from yours, but I've actually seen components popping up more and more frequently online. Sometimes, depending on the component, they are selling out quickly, but frankly, you can find these 175 grain Match Kings just about anywhere right now. There are a lot of 308 Winchester fans out there, so I thought, let's do some more work in 308. Without putting in a significant amount of effort, I was actually able to find this 175 grain Match King in Federal's Gold Medal Match in stock both locally as well as online. Prices aren't great, but at least there is some availability. So everyone's complaint, and I hear you, is primers. Oh, the glorious primers that are not in stock. But in my local shop, they had both large and small rifle primers in stock. Not at prices I would like, but at $11 per 100, there is some availability, and at least for the moment, that might be the price we need to pay to move forward. Though the powder shelves there were mostly empty, there was some H4895 on the shelf, and I've been waiting to try it out. So today was going to be that day. I've never used a specific powder, in 308 or otherwise. But I thought this would be a great example of what I do with a brand new powder that I've never tried before in anything. In addition to this, a little while ago, I was able to stumble on some AR comp. Not as much as I was hoping for, but hey, I did get some. So the combinations we got might not have been exactly what I was looking for, but I think we can make some progress. No matter what powder you have available to you, likely you'll be able to find something that works. As far as brass is concerned, 308 Winchester brass has actually had some reasonable availability, even on premium cases like Lapua, which, if you're looking for the best results possible, I would highly recommend. Everybody's situation and desires are going to be a little bit different, but didn't have to look too far to find some 308 Winchester brass in stock, though we're not using it for today's loads. So for those of you that might be new to the game, this probably isn't an uncommon situation. Having to reload what's available, not exactly what you wanted or the internet told you was the best option that you had to have, but we just can't sit around and complain, or we're going to have to try and learn something new. I'm up for trying something new today. I would love to explain this load development process in great detail, but I do have a playlist that already covers it in that level of detail, and I'm going to link that at the end of the video if you really are interested. The quick version of this process is there are several steps. The first step when doing load development is finding jam, or essentially the cartridge over length you're going to need to load. For today's 308 Winchester load, it's going to be really easy, because we just can't get to the lands, at least with a reasonable cartridge overall length. Just to touch the lands with this projectile in the rifle that we're using would have a cartridge overall length of 2.944 inches. That's not our jam point, that's our touch point. So unless we plan on single feeding these, which I have no interest in, we are going to be jumping today. And frankly, for the sake of being able to run pretty much any magazine, we're going to keep the cartridge over length to 2.820 inches. For our second step, we would normally test both powder and primer at the same time. However, I'm going to add an extra step simply because we have not tested these powders before, not just in our caliber, but at all period, at least on my reloading bench. I'll explain it in more detail in just a second. For step three, after we found our appropriate powder and primer combination that we want to use, we would adjust our cartridge overall length to get the best groups possible. And step number four is to validate that by adjusting our powder charge up and down by a few tenths of a grain to make sure that we are able to retain the good groups that we got with step three. If you'd like to see me walk through this in 6.5 Creedmoor, I do have an example in the playlist, but let me know if you guys are interested in seeing this in 308, and maybe I'll do a series on it in 308 as well. Now for today's test, we're working with two powders, again, I've never used before. So I really want to test how these are going to respond in our platform. In contrary to what I do most of the time, I'm going to be using some brass from factory ammo that this time will actually be its fifth firing. You may be wondering, and it's a valid question, why would we be wasting our time with this brass rather than the brass we intended to do our final load development with? And there's two good reasons. The first is even though we have exact load data for these combinations in our caliber, I still want to test it, and I don't want to chance wrecking any of my good Lapua brass to damage it, finding out what our initial pressure responses are going to be. And the second reason, still related to the first, is that I had this factory brass left over, and testing this just to get an initial response still allows me to maintain the same round counts on my lapel brass, and so I don't have to have some that's been fired more or less than others. My primary goal with this test is just to see the velocity response and to make sure that the pressures were safe in the ranges that I wanted to test. If history has taught me anything, when I was working with my 338, I used some powders that I just came nowhere close to the velocity that I expected, and some of the powders I tested gave much higher velocities than I anticipated. My recommendation in this case is when we've never tested the powder before, we just want to make sure that the loads are close to our expectations that I have for them. If everything's going to work okay, we're just going to end up repeating this test to some degree with the brass we intend to use. But again, I'm making sure that the relative range that we're going to test is going to be safe in our rifle. I believe the story will be better understood when we discuss the load data. So let's start with H4895. Now going to Sierra, they're stating a max load to be 42.5 grains at a velocity of around 2630 feet per second, if I had a 24-inch barrel, which I do not. The barrel we'll be using today is only 20 inches, so we very well may not reach that velocity. In fact, if we input this data into quick load, it's estimating we're only going to hit 2560 feet per second. And when we shot the same gold medal match, 175 grain match gain load, the estimated box velocity was 2600 feet per second. When we chronographed those loads, we got somewhere real close to 2550 feet per second. Losing 50 feet per second from the load data probably is a reasonable expectation. Besides Sierra's data, we're also going to take a look at the Hodgkin website, since they make the powder. At 42.7 grains, their estimated velocity will be 2647 feet per second at max. Though putting that information to quick load, it does estimate our velocity higher at 2571 feet per second, but it's also only estimating a case pressure of 56,523 psi. This is a 62,000 psi case. So if quick load was to be believed, we're leaving velocity on the table. Trusting these manufacturers have some idea how these components are going to work, we're going to be sticking with the limits that they impose, so our max on the H4895 is going to be that 42.7 grains. AR Comp, on the other hand, is not going to be quite as easy. Sierra is claiming a max of 42.7 grains at 2640 feet per second. Again, this is for 24-inch barrels. But looking at the Alliant website, things are a lot less clear. Again, for the same combination on Alliant's website, they are claiming 41.4 grains is going to give us a velocity of 2719 feet per second in that same 24-inch barrel. 1.3 grains less powder, and almost 80 feet per second faster. Certainly a much bigger gap in the data than we saw with the H4895. Looking at quick load, it's going to estimate max to be somewhere around 41.9 grains, and that's at 61,387 psi. So using quick load to estimate the pressure, Sierra's data is supposedly going to take us all the way to 65,187 psi. Today we are going to stick with those Sierra load data numbers, but we're going to be starting low enough on our chart to make sure we're within safe pressures and monitor that as we increase the charge weight. For both of our load tests today, we're going to be using the Sierra 175 grain Match King, part number 2275. For H4895 load, we're going to be using Hornady brass, 5 times fired. Like I said before, the cartridge overall length for both of these loads will be 2.820 inches. And with our short action custom set, that's going to give us a CBTO of about 2.125. So like I said, we had 19 pieces of Hornady brass to use, so we're going to be starting at that 42.7 grain charge and backing down in 0.2 grain increments, and we're going to be doing 19 shots overall. So our minimum charge is going to be starting at 39.1 grains, again, of H4895, increasing in those 0.2 of a grain increments all the way up to 42.7 grains. So for our first test, we're going to be able to start way low and get a good idea of our pressure response as we increase this charge weight. The primer we're using today is a Federal 210M. To be completely fair, these weren't in stock at the local store. However, if I was in a jam, I certainly would have just used the 210s that they did have on the shelf. In other testing I've done, I haven't seen a difference in between them. The Hornady brass that we're using for the H4895 loads has been fired 5 times. We anneal it and push the shoulder back about 2/1000ths with a full length size. Now, for the AR Comp loads we're going to test, that is Federal brass that came from our Federal gold medal match previously fired loads. It's been fired 5 times now as well. There are only 15 cases for it, and we're going to be using a max charge of 42.9 grades of the AR Comp. Backing down in 2/10 of a grain increments, we're going to be starting at 40.1 grains and increasing in 2/10 of a grain increments all the way to 42.9 grains. 40.1 grains should be well below max for both of our sources of data. So again, we should be starting in plenty safe territory and look for our pressure signs as we go. For our H4895, starting at 39.1 grains, we started off at 2375 feet per second. And I'll post the chart on the screen so you can see all the way up to 42.7 grains, we actually reached a measured velocity with our lab radar at 2641 feet per second. Certainly well above the estimates we thought we were going to achieve today. If we were looking to be in the range of where we thought we were going to be, as well as kind of the performance we expected to get out of our gold medal match loads, we would be somewhere around that 41.7 to 42.3 grain area, so that 2550 or just a little bit higher. I really wouldn't put any credence to it, but I know somebody's going to ask, and I really like the shot marker, as you can see the shots as they progress in the groups. And so our 19-shot group from our H4895 had an overall size of 1.35 MOA. Keep in mind, that's a very large extreme spread from top to bottom on the velocity for them to all be expected to go into the same hole. And again, I don't really think the groups mean anything, but if you looked at the 41.3 grain to 42.3 grain charge, just because I thought it was fun, those four shots on our shot marker system go into just under half of an MOA. Again, we really need to go through our full load development process, but I thought that was a very interesting starting point. Now, moving up to our AR comp load, keeping in mind, starting at 40.1 grains, our actual velocity measured with our lab radar was 2576 feet per second. In our federal brass, we had a very linear response, and at 42.7 grains, we actually finished out at 2720 feet per second in our 20-inch barrel. So the velocities we measured today ended up being larger than any of our data sources told us. But what we're really concerned is pressure signs. So let's take a look at our brass. Looking at our H4895 loads, looking at the case heads for pressure signs here, you can see no real serious pressure signs. Nothing on our cases is going to tell us otherwise, except that the cases are wearing out. But we'll cover that in a second. Moving over to AR comp, seeing much higher velocities and very likely much higher pressures. We had just a touch of primer cratering, even on our low charge, but as far as like scary pressure signs, we really didn't see anything. There's a little bit of an ejector mark starting at the 42.1 grain load that gets a little bit more pronounced as we get to 41.9 grains, but as far as anything being very scary, there wasn't anything visible in our loads today. That being said, I'm really tending to believe more of alliance data in this case, and if we do any load development in the future with this particular combination, I think we'll be backing that charge weight down at least a little bit. Honestly, if we were even trying to mimic the velocity of the gold medal match loads, we'd be right down at where we started at today. Now, as far as groups were concerned, and again, we're really not concerned with groups as far as this type of testing is concerned, but I know somebody's going to ask, our AR comp didn't do quite as well. Our overall group size for 15 rounds was 1.5 MOA. As far as the chart was concerned, I was very happy to see the very linear response. Even if we went somewhere around the 40.3 to 40.7 grain area, it looks to me there might very well be a nice node there, but again, we're going to have to do some more testing. Overall, the data we generated today isn't really earth-shattering, but we did get a good idea with these two different powders as far as the powder and charge weight and pressure that we could expect if we move this into another case with a similar case volume. I do have to say that the AR comp responded with much higher velocities than I thought it would, but you can look at the pressure signs for yourself. One thing that you might have missed when we were looking at pressure signs, because mostly I'm talking about pressure signs on the case head, we can see on the Hornady brass we're starting to see signs of case head separations that may be coming very soon. This will be the last time I use this lot of Hornady brass, and again, only 5 firings. I don't think any of the firings have been severely over pressure by any means, but clearly it's lived its life and it's going to be done. People wonder all the time why I ask why you might want to look at a more premium brass brand. This is one of the reasons. This Hornady brass has clearly worn itself out a little bit faster than any of the other 3/8 brass I've tested so far. The federal cases have been through the same amount of firings, clearly higher pressures today, and as far as signs of case head separation, there aren't any that I've been able to find so far. But if any of you guys have opinions on that, I'm sure you're going to be leaving it in the comments section below. If you're interested in seeing this loading process from start to finish, check out this playlist here where I cover all the details you're going to want to see. If you want to see this whole process put out in 308 Winchester, leave that feedback in the comment section below, and I hope to see you guys come back next week. And until then, stay safe in small groups.